Now, I'm not gonna lie to you, trying to write a story and, you know, putting it out there on that level, I'm not gonna hold you. I'm very still new to it. And when I look across the internet, just looking at other people and fan fictions and the memes and tropes that kind of come with it, especially when it comes to just characters in general having terrible backstories and how that's just a common thing, to be perfectly honest, it's just like, yeah, I can see how people can, you know, clown on that for an idea, honestly, when it comes to it. Obviously, lo and behold, my characters also have some of those same qualities of a tragic backstory. But honestly, I wasn't intending to go the way it was going to go with them, but at the very same time, it just kind of led into that. So I want to talk a bit about the backstories of some of the dream girls and kind of go and talk about a few of them in depth, honestly, which will mainly be Symphony and a little bit of Shion as well. But also, I'm not gonna hold you, because these backstories are traumatic, I will give you a warning: a lot of them has to do with SA. If you know what SA stands for, then yeah, I'm pretty sure you're gonna, you know, maybe feel a bit uncomfortable. So if you don't really feel like watching this one, I don't blame you. And if you do like this video, or if you just wanna, you know, make it to the end, I'll let you hug Shion, and I'll tell you how to do that at the very end of things. So let's get to it. Now, I've talked about a few backstories of certain characters in their own separate videos before, and some way in hinting in their own series. The only people that don't really suffer a tragic backstory in terms of, you know, the same thing as everybody else does with SA, essentially, is Sarutame and Aoki. Those are the only two characters that actually have not gone through that, but literally everybody else, they have. So when it comes down to it, let's start off with Blue, because Blue is the main girl that a lot of you guys know, a lot of you guys have seen first, because she was first. And when it comes down to it, the character that honestly probably still could use a bit of work when it comes to just throwing herself out there for you guys to understand her a bit more. But when it comes down to it though, I'm not going to try to give fully everybody's backstory, because some of them have already been explained and some of them I still want to do it for a specific video. But when it comes down to it, Blue was hinting in the story recently with her mom that the reason why she hates her mom and the reason why she ran away is because her aunt did something to her. Now, you can obviously imply what that is, because, you know, it just feels like the tension is there for you to kind of take that guess. But essentially, I have created these scenes, or at least the moments of their distress, so you can kind of understand exactly what's going on. So for Blue, she was basically on the bed and, you know, her aunt was trying to touch her and get up on her in some weird and disgusting way. But when it comes down to it, that's also when she unlocked her power of, you know, reject. And that's when she actually was able to reject her aunt off of her, killing her with that damn energy. And when it comes down to it, that's when she decided to, you know, run away. And, you know, to be honest with you, it's when it comes down to Blue compared to everybody else, this is light. Unfortunately, this is light, but at the very same time, it's still pretty damn heavy. Then we go to Shoko, who is, you know, obviously the princess of her own damn world, but at the very same time, when she was trying to confront her parents to do, you know, to stop them from doing some nonsense in the city from this war happening between the higher class people and the lower class people, you know, they try to make her obedient and essentially pin her down to bed and try to do things to her. But then she, you know, unlocked her power of indomitability by despair and literally rampaged and killed both of her parents and took down the whole castle where she used to live. So that's also like a whole thing. And then also at the same time, you had Yukari, who was also in that very same world where Shoko was. And you saw she didn't really, you know, get harmed herself, but she did see her mom getting, you know, McDonald's rampaged and killed right after. And that led her to have a hatred towards the world and towards the people that did that to her. And while she didn't unlock it later, while she didn't unlock it in that moment, she did unlock her power of corruption later at some point in time, you know, when she moved into Shoko's house and, you know, kind of started that whole war between the higher up people and the lower class people as well in that very same city. Then you have someone like Symphony, who gone through that shit a lot, which, to be honest, I had an idea what her backstory was going to be, but then I decided to change an idea of it, or at least not so change it to retcon it, but like add some more context as to why things happened, because her family was in debt, and so she basically had to be, you know, carted off to these people that, you know, kind of owns the debt and whatever. And essentially she was basically used, beaten, and all that type of stuff until she literally gave up on herself and became a nightmare, which obviously is the worst thing that can happen if you fall into your dream and give up on yourself like that. And she literally awakened her power of biologics, which led her to basically killing everybody on that planet and every single animal on that damn planet as well. So she has the highest kill count of literally any character. Then Shion, who literally was a part of a cult's village, who was, you know, doing what she honestly, unfortunately, had to be a part of. And while she turned when she turned seven, she had to go through all that stuff too, with the leaders of the village basically using her in different ways, whether it's to handle business outside of the whole village to keep them safe and expand, while also being violated by those leaders, and hell, even having parades in her honor of getting violated as a blessing to her whole village, honestly. And, you know, she had to kind of deal with that until, you know, she actually died and then put to a whole prison for 4,000 years. So, to be perfectly honest with you, these girls been through a lot of damn things. And again, as I said yesterday, one person mentioned that every single character went through SA. Now, to be perfectly honest, I'll be completely transparent with you here. This may have come from, at least when it comes to the idea of them going through that, may have come from a real place of my own experience. While I have not gone through anything nearly as rough and terrible as that, you know, it does affect me. And honestly, it probably is the reason why I am the way I am. But when it comes down to it, it feels like, and I wasn't even trying to do this for these characters, but it just kind of bled through. And it's just like, well, if that is what it is, then so be it, honestly. At least, you know, I have characters that also can kind of, you know, I can feel as my comfort characters when it comes down to it, to, I guess, express that through them, right? And there's so much about this, honestly, that probably make you feel uncomfortable about it too. Because you're probably thinking, wait, if these characters been through all this shit, and they're in this type of series where so many lewd things happen, why would you have them keep going through that type of shit? Why would you have them do that, right? Why does Jay need to clap them every single time when they're on screen, or do something crazy lewd with them when the chance happens? Here's the thing, right? Yeah, they've been through something bad. They've been through a lot of bad things. But when it comes down to it, the reason why they were with Jay is because Jay's not an asshole. He's not an evil ass person. He's actually the better person to kind of be around. Yes, he's a pervert at times, but he wouldn't necessarily do anything to harm those girls. And to be honest, trying to save them and trying to help them whenever they need help, honestly, lets them kind of see Jay as their own light. And when it comes down to it, they kind of depend and kind of need him in a way, right? It's kind of messed up, but at the very same time, they don't necessarily hate the idea of being around him. And that's what makes them feel comfortable to do a lot of the stuff when they, you know, are about that life when it comes to him and such. And Jay has to carry the baggage of basically caring for them. Like, one of the best examples I would say that happened in the show is essentially Symphony breaking down into Jay's arms before the whole, you know, crazy points of that arc kind of happened, when they first talked about the past and, you know, kind of go about things. Because, you know, Jay never had dealt with anybody that had broke down in front of him like that. So trying to be there for Symphony and giving like all the care for her in the world, that's something new to him. And while, yes, you know, getting some clappy is good times, but at the same time, you got to care about them on a more in-depth level. And he realizes this. They sure may be dreams and sure may have come from a different place than he did, but that doesn't mean they should be treated as a different being as a whole, you know. And then recently with Shion and the whole Nick situation, you know, Jay basically tried to help Shion as much as he could as well. Having that experience with Symphony kind of helps him know what to do here, even if he doesn't know if he can, you know, stop Nyx from doing what she was trying to do And eventually he did, and things worked out for the better, and now she can actually smile for once. For me personally, if you ask me who is like the most mentally broken girl out of all of them though, I would argue it's between Shion. And even though that, you know, Symphony in her case is actually pretty decent-ish now, she still has that tendency to be not necessarily fully there. To be honest, I created Symphony, or at least how I look at her now, she's like the dark implications of, you know, I would say of me in a way, because when it comes down to it, she kind of just would do a lot of crazy things without necessarily like caring too much about doing the better part of it, you know. So that's why she was easily able to, you know, almost destroy the entire safe haven, because she was just on that type of timing, because she is that type of timing. Hell, to be honest, because she killed basically everybody in her own world, when she finally got to see Jay, to be honest, that was like the first time she actually felt like someone gave a shit, someone could care. And while she didn't necessarily fully trust that things will work out, she fully dedicated herself to him. To be honest, in my mind, of what Symphony really is at that first moment in time, she was just dedicated to Jay completely. If Jay told her to off herself, she would probably do it without any type of hesitation. But obviously Jay would never ask that of her. And when we actually do save her, and we get to the point of where she is now, she still have dark implications. She still will follow Jay no matter what happens, and will cling to him no matter what. But at the very same time, now that she has been saved, and you know, all the other people were trying to help her, like Blue and the others, now she will also sit down and kind of rely on them too when it comes down to it. But Jay is still like her main priority. If something happens to him, who knows if she'll even stay stable, honestly. So that's the thing to kind of look out for. And as far as Shion goes, while we haven't really seen her completely break down, she can very much do so. Yes, she had 4,000 years to be alone and not necessarily be bothered by anybody, but still nonetheless, that doesn't necessarily mean that she doesn't harbor any type of, you know, mental tragedies and breakdowns, and that could potentially happen to her. So, you know, still very much keep a good ass eye on her, because things could go kind of crazy if things aren't taken care of in the way they need to. And to kind of bring it up a little bit more further is to kind of mention about the moment where, you know, Symphony and Blue, before all that crazy stuff happened in her arc kind of happened, they walked into the hallway together and they started crying for each other. There is a story reason as to why that happened, and it's not really apparently like super obvious as to what it could be, but I know what the cause is, and you know, we'll get to that point when we get to that point. But that also kind of just shows you that there is pain between these girls, that they can feel each other pain, honestly. And it's not just for, you know, Symphony and Blue, they can feel it mainly, but Shoko and the others could probably feel it as well. So when it comes down to it though, a lot of these girls have been through a lot of things. And what the main point of what I wanted to do, really, once I figured out that that's the route I was going, I wanted to make sure that the reason why they like Jay is actually valid and not necessarily some cheap anime cop-out nonsense that a lot of harem shows does. He talked to me. He was like there. He was, you know, saving me from whatever random bullying nonsense or whatever, you know, like most anime do. So I wanted to give like a super big in-depth reason as to why, right? And that point, you know, that's why I really wanted to be extremely valid, because at the end of the day, these girls deserve to be happy at the end of it, right? And while they may still have to suffer and deal with despair, it's not like it's as bad as it once was, essentially, right? Still, you know, gotta care for them, and you know, gotta treat them in the way they need to be. But at the very same time, at least they have Jay and us to kind of, you know, lean on when it comes down to things, right? Puts a lot of stress and pressure on him, but at the same time, you know, they'll do what they can for each other. And I think that's the most important part of their relationship, to be honest. Well, that was a heavy and a lot of stuff. So here you go. hug the Shion. If you want to hug the Shion, press the like button, honestly. If you don't hug the Shion, use a bitch. Just gonna put that out there. But to be perfectly honest, yeah, I love these girls, really. And despite giving them tragic backstories, honestly, that honestly feels a bit terrible, not gonna lie, but when it comes down to it, it just makes me like their character more, that they endured all that stuff and still carry on and try to do their very best, honestly. And that just makes me, you know, feel a bit more enjoying the time when I do write these characters and, you know, craft their stories into these sort of ways. Because yeah, I could just easily make this a silly joking harem story or a super light and easy story, but I want this shit to be kind of hard and, you know, in depth when it comes down to it, but also at the same time showing them that even though they went through all this stuff, they can still have a good time at the end of it, right? So that just kind of is what it is. But that's essentially what I really wanted to say for this one, mainly to talk about their trauma and kind of talk about their headspaces and kind of how they are as characters. And yeah, it's a lot of heavy subjects and a lot of heavy stuff that's in it, but hopefully you still enjoyed if you did, you know, kind of watch this whole thing all the way. So if you did, congratulations and thank you. So that's really all I wanted to say for this one, so hopefully you did enjoy. If you did, be sure to like, share, subscribe, hit the bell notification when you're out. Also, I'm on socials and like to the channel. Kofi and Cash App is available as well. And so this is Boy J, signing off. Have a blessed day.